things and the new clothes that represent our sin, repentance is and confession is like spray and wash, which we just bathe our kids' stuff in, especially after Disney the other day when we like looked at them and went, I'm not even going to ask how the chocolate ended up on that spot. I'm not going to ask. We'll just treat it when we get home. Well, as Sam mentioned in the video announcements, and if you needed help translating, especially Gray, who came out of his shell, the outtake reel for that one was better than the original because Gray started acting out scenes from a movie, and then he took the camera and filmed his own announcement of gum that was available through the slot in my office door. So Marjorie, if you found some extra gum stuck to something, that's where that came from. But in your bulletin, you do have this guide. It's a prayer guide. We're coming into the Easter season. It's hard to believe that it's going to be here in just a few weeks. And at Easter, we as Southern Baptists collect for North American missions. At Christmas, we collect for international missions, but at Easter, it's for missions at home. And while the choir was singing, I was struck by the scale of lostness just in our own backyard. So when a lot of times we think about missions, we think about it being over there and in a different country and a 12-hour plane flight and statues and huts. But in North America, we are the fourth or fifth largest mission field. India, China, Indonesia, and then it's a toss-up depending on what source, the U.S. or Russia in fourth and fifth place interchangeably depending on the source that you look at. 75% of the people that you pass every day in North America have no relationship with Jesus, no hope for eternity. And that's just in our backyard. And so when we give for Annie Armstrong, we're giving to help church planters and chaplains and college ministers, missionaries across our country, Canada, and Mexico. Take the gospel to those 273 million people who, if they died today, would spend eternity separated from God. Well, we're picking back up Ephesians chapter 4. We're in verses 17 through 24. And I told Carrie, I got sucked down the Wikipedia black hole yesterday looking up Oscar hosts because I was just curious who had hosted the Oscars, and I never knew that actually the lead, I always thought Billy Crystal had hosted the most, Bob Hope has. Donald Duck hosted the Oscars 1 year. Chris Rock has done it twice. There's been a few years where they didn't have one. And so we had the Oscars this past Sunday, and most of us probably didn't watch it. It's not that interesting anymore. But one of the things that jumped out was one of the candidates for Best Picture was Black Panther. And it opened up this whole thing of this black hole of realizing that we are in kind of a golden age of superhero movies. They're coming out left and right. The Marvel Universe, and Nathaniel's running through the number in his head right now that are out or have come out because this is his forte. And so they're all about these superheroes, and so we're developing these movies, we're doing crossovers, my kids are freaking out about them, but they can't watch them because they're slipping in too much violence. But let's imagine these movies. And you tell me how interesting they would be. Peter Parker, bit by the radioactive spider, wakes up the next morning, realizes that he has spider abilities. And so he starts a blog. Superman. Clark Kent comes of age. He realizes that he has powers. And he learns that he has a fortress of solitude. That he turns into a man cave. The Incredible Hulk, Bruce Banner, comes up with the formula, transforms into the Hulk, and becomes a circus strongman. Tony Stark, Iron Man, if you're not familiar, comes up with this incredible technology and turns it into a battle bot for late night cable television. Some of you are, this is just gone over your head. But some of you are hearing that and you're going, how disappointing to have a life with that kind of ability, have a life with that kind of significance, and you just throw it away. As Christians, we can't be transformed by the gospel and just sit on it and not live set apart. The last half of Ephesians basically functions as an owner's manual for how the gospel transforms us, and it leads to kind of this practical outworking. Last week, it was really interesting. Of all the things Paul could start with, he doesn't start with behavior. He starts with unity in the church. This week, it is all about how our new life looks compared to our old. And so let's read Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 through 24. Paul says, "Now this I say, and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity." Verse 20, "But that is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness." And if we were to take all of this and kind of capture it down, it would be this idea that gospel transformation leads to new life. That if we're transformed by the gospel, it changes the way that we live. So let's pray and let's dive in. Father, we thank you so much that you have given us new life, that you've taken what was old, that you've taken what was tattered, that was corrupt, that loved its sin, and you changed it. You transformed it into the image of Christ that we live for and we live towards every day. Help us to walk in that new life. In Jesus' name, amen. I want us to look at a couple of things from this. The first is from verses 17 through 19, that the new life is markedly distinct. So this is where Paul is kind of setting the table, and he tells us in verse 17, this isn't me, this is God. This is testifying in the Lord. He's bringing some weight behind what he has to say. And his point is very simple. If we've been transformed by the gospel, it will carry over into how we live. Namely, we're not going to live like we once were. We're not going to do things the way we once did. There's no room for Paul or in the New Testament for the idea of the carnal Christian, the Christian who trusts Christ but then does whatever they want. And Paul will tell us in 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11, he says, "Don't be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, idolaters, adulterers, men who practice homosexuality, thieves, the greedy, drunkards, revilers, or swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God." And then he drops a hammer in verse 11. "And such were some of you." This was the story of what many in the Corinthian church had been before they met Christ. They were outside of the promise. They were outside of the will of God. They were living that old flesh. And such were. Present tense, past tense. Past tense, yeah. Wake up, here we go. Come on. Okay. All right. Were, past tense. "But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God." The new life's markedly distinct. It doesn't mean that we do things the way we always used to. It doesn't mean that we live the way that we used to. It doesn't work like that anymore. And Paul gives a picture, kind of this progression that Will's going to pop up on the screen that shows how this works. It starts with ignorance. We start with ignorance. And when we're talking about ignorance, we're not necessarily meaning, I don't believe, that they didn't know any better. Because Romans 1 tells us that the creation itself bears witness that there's a God, that we should look at creation and go, you know, maybe there's something more here. What this is rather probably looking at, and kind of the vein that we're talking about here, is when you get pulled over for blowing through a stop sign and you try to come up with the excuse, "I didn't know I couldn't do that." Does that carry any weight at all? No, because what does the sign say? Stop. It's not rolling stop. It's not no cop, no stop. It's not stop if you feel like it. It says stop. And so this ignorance isn't necessarily, I didn't know any better. It's, I didn't know I couldn't do that. And so it starts with ignorance, where we are
willfully rejecting what we know to be true. We are not acknowledging the truth that is plainly revealed to us, which leads to hardness. Once we don't know and we do it, then it leads to hardness, which leads to futility. See, it's hardness because we keep doing it so it becomes normal, and then we realize that it's completely futile. There's a reason why sin doesn't work. It's not supposed to. There's a reason why dysfunctional relationships don't work. They're not supposed to. There's a reason why addiction and drunkenness and whatever form of immorality you want to mention, the reason why it doesn't work, it's not supposed to. Amen. And so it's futile. So you see this futility going into it. It's like when we get the instructions for a project and we reject what we've known to be true, and it gets difficult and it becomes futile, that we end up being calloused by it. And we don't realize that it's harder to get the feeling that we once did. So this is what happens so many times with addiction, with alcoholism, is when it used to take 2 drinks to feel something, now it takes 7 for you to feel anything. The addict who's on drugs, they used to get the high every time, and now they don't. And for many of those addicts, it's not so much chasing the high, it's avoiding the come down. And so the drug becomes this futility because they become so calloused to anything that's real that they chase after the high, not for the high, but because they don't want the come down. Do you see the cycle of futility, the cycle of brokenness, the cycle of addiction, of abuse, where we don't even recognize it anymore because we're living in this endless cycle? Sin is not supposed to work. I love this quote. It'll take you farther than you want to go, leave you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. And it looks like, and Paul gives a couple of examples here, sensuality and every kind of impurity. And you get a little bit of this from Romans 1, 18-32. I'd commend that to your reading. If you want to look at what this means to live the old life, to live the old self, it's this idea of ignorance, hardness, futility, and callousness. And that's on display in Romans 1, 18-32, where they're given all the attributes of God that are available in creation and willfully rejecting it, saying, I didn't know I couldn't do that. They worship the creation. It leads to hardness. It leads to futility of relationships, of sexuality, all of these things, ultimately to a point of callousness where you just don't even feel it anymore. If you've gotten a callous from sewing or from working with your hands, you could take a needle and pop and not even feel it. Could you? Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's what happens with callousness. So it looks like this. It looks like sensuality, and it looks like every kind of impurity. When we're thinking about this idea of sensuality, it's another way to think about it is the word lewdness, and that's an old word that's not used much anymore. This is talking about sexual sin. For the Christian, this is a big deal for us. Sexual sin has been, is, and will continue to be a big deal for Christians living as salt and light in a world that basically looks at sex and sexual satisfaction as whenever, however, whomever. And if you look at the history of the world, that is how sexual sin is put on display. Whenever, however, whomever. This is nothing novel that we're going through now. This has been around since the fall of Eden, of trying to figure out ways to gratify ourselves sexually when God has given a pattern and a prescription for that that is unique. The context of lifelong monogamous marriage. That's the difference between a fireplace and a forest fire. Okay, Florida people, you don't know anything about fireplaces because it doesn't ever get cold enough here, all right? But go back to your previous days when you had a fireplace, when you had a bonfire, and it would be a contained fire. You could get warmth. You could roast marshmallows on it. You could do all of these things with a contained fire. That's sex within marriage. It's contained. It's inflamed. It's passionate. It's good. God gave it to us as a gift. We're not like previous generations that looked at sex as something to be avoided. Sex is something that God gave to us in marriage to enjoy. But it came with a warning attached to it that said anything outside of this protected, secure, covenant, lasting, lifelong relationship, is like going out into the woods with a can of gas and a match. It's going to be destructive. It's going to be destructive, not just to you, but to people around you. That's why sexual sin is such a big deal for believers, and it's why in the New Testament, every other sin, we fight. When it comes to sexual sin, you run as fast as you can away. You don't fight this. You don't fight a forest fire with a bucket of water. It doesn't work. It won't do it. So for us as believers, we remember that there's three categories of relationship in the Bible. We have three categories. This comes from a book called Sex, Dating, and Relationships. It's a book that almost actually got me fired, actually, as a youth pastor, because I taught this, and someone didn't like it, and they raised a big stink about it. So as long as you guys promise that you're not going to fire me over this one, I'll tell you what the book's about. All right? The book gives three categories of relationships that are in the Bible. Neighbor, family, spouse. That's it. That's all there is. So you have family, genetic relationships, kinfolk, as they say back where we come from. That's the ones that you're related to. That's how we relate to family. So when we relate to family, purity, impurity. Purity. We relate to our family with purity. We don't look at family sexually. Spouse. This person that you're married to. If you ever want to know, did I marry the right person? Look on the marriage certificate, see what name is there. You married the right person. Hallmark, and we pick at each other about this, but Hallmark really made a bunch of money on the one. The one is the one that you married. Not the one that you think you should have married because the one that you've got now isn't the right model or whatever it is. The one is the one that you married. That's how you know if you married the one. It's the one that you're married to. All right, in that context, free from sexual activity, or is that part of it? It's part of it. Okay, so that's the one category. Then you have neighbor. This is boyfriend, girlfriend, person that lives across the street, person you work with, all of that. Purity or impurity? Purity. So apart from your spouse, in that protected covenant relationship, God expects purity. Now, just like we talked about with the clothes, are you going to get dirty stains on your clothes every now and then? Yes. Here's the reality. It is one of those things, and I was talking about this with a friend of ours, and I said, it is harder and harder to find even believers who don't have some kind of baggage when it comes to this. That's why we're grateful for grace. That's why we're grateful for grace that covers our sin. That's why we're grateful for grace that washes it away. Because it's not something that any of us can truly say that we're immune to anymore. It's such a big deal that the guy that's the contestant on The Bachelor right now, which I don't watch, I just saw it on Twitter and went, we're really making a big deal out of this one? Like, it's front page news that he's a virgin. And this is just blowing up everything. Like, what do you mean? I'm like, maybe he sees the destruction and it's like, I don't want to do that. But for our world, that's completely incomprehensible. So that's what it looks like. That's why sexual sin for a believer is a big deal. And I know this is awkward to talk about, but if we're going to talk about it anywhere, we might as well talk about it in church rather than let the world speak into it, because the world's message is however, whomever, whenever.
That's right.
So what we're talking about here, so this is one of those things that the new life is distinctly marked by, is that we're not chasing after that. Second thing is every kind of impurity. Now that's basically just a catch-all. Okay? That's a word for uncleanness. It means there's this one particular thing. And the fact that it's particular shouldn't be lost on us. That God has high standards for those who call themselves Christians when it comes to sexual sin. And then he has the catch-all for everything else. And he says all kinds of other uncleanness. So this came up in our Sunday school class last week when we asked the question, how should Christians look and live different from the rest of the world? And there's always that like awkward silence where it's like, this is too obvious of a question. Are we really going to ask this? Who's going to finally answer it? And Heidi puts up her hand. She goes, every possible way? Yeah, this is something that when we think of this, every kind of impurity, anything that falls into a pattern of living apart from God's good and wonderful design. Here's the question. Just ask, what would Jesus do? What would Jesus have me do? If the answer is anything but yes, don't do that. Does God want me to, ... If you have to ask, 9 times out of 10, what's the answer? No. Do this with our kids. They have to ask us if they can do something. We just kind of look at them and go, if you have to ask, do you already know what the answer is? You're going to say no, right? Mm-hmm. We are going to say no. Yes, you cannot jump off of the bed. No, you cannot use that as a weapon. That's what it is. So we ask ourselves this. This whole idea of every kind of impurity is this something that is part of God's good and wonderful design? And if the answer is anything but yes, let's stay away from it. Does that mean you're going to live differently? Absolutely. I love how Dave Ramsey talks about this when he talks about people getting out of debt. As he says, live like no one else does now so that you can live like no one else later. And that's true for us. So live like no one else does so that later you can live like no one else does. Now that's the negative, okay? This is all the stuff we're not supposed to do. This is old self. This is Gentiles. This is who we were before Christ. New life, new self. The new life, the new self pursues holiness. So in verse 20, Paul gives us another one of these. And look, the book of Ephesians is so easy to work through. Just look for the word clues that Paul drops. Got these nows and therefores and fors and buts. And when you see a but, that's where you're going one direction and you're changing course. Okay, you're going one way, but, it says here, but that is not the way, or but God, or but Christ, or but you. And it comes back around. So it says here, but this is not the way that you learn Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus. So he's saying, okay, if you got it, if you got saved, if you got transformed by the gospel, now this is what it looks like. Put off, put on. It's easier said than done, but this is that whole thing of habits that we do. Habits of holiness, spiritual disciplines, the way that we live is this constant series of putting off and putting on. And just like Kim was talking about with the clothes, we put off the dirty clothes. We put on the clean ones. We put off the bad habits. We put off the destructive things. We put off the sin. We put on righteousness. It's easier said than done. That's why this is a discipline. That's why this is work. This is a habit. That's why if you ever notice, and I had a friend of mine post a picture from the gym just a couple weeks ago. Snapped a picture, went, boy, gym's empty today, isn't it? Guess where all those New Year's resolutions people were. Okay? That's why it's hard work. That's why it's put off, put on. Put off the old self. It's what's corrupted through deceitful desires. Here's the wonder of a Christian's testimony is that who they once were is not who they are now. Putting off that old self, whatever it looked like, whatever it was, whether it was anger or bitterness or divisiveness or lustful, whatever it was, you're putting that off. You're not that anymore because you've been changed, you've been transformed by Christ. You've truly been changed. And that's what he's very clear in verse 20, is that if you've truly been changed, it's going to look different. You're going to act different. Amen. And it's not, and that's why it's always one of those things, especially when I was a youth pastor, I would tell our kids, I really don't care what you say. And they'd be like, what? I'm like, I don't really care what you say. Your words don't mean anything. What means something is your actions. And so that's why whenever we come back from camp and like little eighth grade Sally was so on fire for Jesus, is we just tap the brakes. And we'd wait a few weeks and see, Is she acting any different at home? Is there fruit from this? Or did she just get caught up in a week where she didn't have her cell phone and she was reading her Bible every day and she realized that something was wrong? We'd always wait and see, has God really changed her heart? Has God really transformed her? Are we seeing something different? Because if we've been transformed, things will look different. So we're putting off that old self. We're also putting on a new self. And that new self looks a lot like Jesus. It lives like Jesus, it thinks like Jesus, it loves like Jesus, and it's marked by two things. And you can see that in verse 24, okay? New self created after the likeness of God. So this is a self that looks
thinks and loves like God does. We don't love like the world. We love like Christ. We don't live like the world. We live like Christ. We start resembling Christ so that people, when they look at us, they don't see old self. They see that something has changed, that there's something even on your countenance that's different, that looks like Jesus. And it's in righteousness and holiness. Here's the thing. This is not perfection, okay? I'm going to go ahead and just dispel all that right now. This is not perfection. Because here's the reality is when we put on the old self and the new self, we live in what scholars will call the already but not yet. Okay? We live in this world where we've already been saved. We've already been transformed. But we're not yet fully there. That's why Christians who love Jesus, who are on fire for him, can stub their toe and cuss. That's why Christians who love Jesus and are on fire for him can still have struggles. Because we've been saved, but we haven't been totally transformed. Perfection is impossible. So when we're talking about this idea of pursuing holiness, we're not talking about perfection, we're talking about progress. We're talking about a process that's moving towards it. So this is where we start looking in the mirror and we go, do I love Jesus more than I did a year ago? Am I living more like him now than I did 1 year ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago? That's what we measure against. Because here's the thing, if we always try to measure ourselves against perfection, we're going to give up because we're never going to be there. We're going to go, well, I can't do it, so what's the point of trying? You're right. You're not. You're not going to get there. You're still going to have bad days. You're still going to say stuff and think stuff and do stuff. That's the whole point of Romans 7, where Paul's like, I don't do the things I want to do, but I do the things I don't want to do. Because he realizes that he's caught in this already, but not yet. So when we're thinking about this idea of pursuing holiness, we're not talking about perfection. We're talking about a life that is marked by it in increasing resemblance to Jesus. Because the older my kids get, the more I realize they are just like me. The older I get, the more I realize I'm just like my dad. And that's what happens, is the older we get, the more we're a Christian, the more we realize that we are becoming like our Father. We are becoming like our Savior. And so if you've been a Christian for 10 years, and you look back and you're like, you know, nothing's really changed in 10 years. That's like the 10-year-old still in diapers. It's cute when a little baby is in diapers and can't feed themselves. But if you're 10, it's time to take the pull-up off and eat with a fork. And so this is a challenge to us. This is a challenge to all of us that we pursue that. And it happens by the renewing of our, in verse 23, you can look there, to be renewed in the spirit of our minds. There's language of conversion, of transformation, of salvation. You can look at Romans 12, look at Colossians 3, where Paul tells us in Romans 12 that by the renewing of our mind, means we get a new mind. When we become Christians, we get a new mind. We think differently than we did before. We think Christianly. We think like Jesus. Our thoughts don't even line up the same way. And if our thoughts don't line up the same way, then our emotions aren't going to line up the same way. And if our thoughts and our emotions don't line up the same way, then our actions aren't going to line up the same way. And that's part of this whole thing of pursuing holiness, pursuing righteousness, pursuing what it means to look like Christ. Does anyone else remember the WWJD bracelets that were all the rave 20 years ago? Yeah, that was fun. There's a lot of truth to that. Because the goal behind that was to look, and throughout your life, to ask, what would Jesus do? Now, WWJD is a lot more memorable than WWJHMD. What would Jesus have me do? So WWJD was easier to remember. But really, we have to ask ourselves, what would Jesus have me do? Pursue holiness, pursue righteousness. think differently, feel differently, live differently. And that's why there's a threefold call this morning. The one is for a call for salvation. Some of you are sitting here and you sat through the Lord's Supper, where we observed, where we participated, where we saw the body and the blood of Christ, and you go, none of this makes any sense. I'm still doing all of these things that are in the old self. This is a call for salvation, for you to trust Christ, for you to put on a new mind, for you to have your minds transformed, your hearts renewed, life come in. Because the reality, and you can look back up there, that ignorance, hardness, futility, callousness, it leads to death. And that's why the Bible tells us that the wages of sin, what happens with sin, isn't life, it's death. See, we think that freedom is freeing when we can do whatever we want, and that's a trap. That's a fishing hook. The fish goes, oh, free food, bite, gotcha. Amen. That's what this does, is it leads to death. But the gift of God is eternal life. So we think what we've got, this hardness, this futility, this callousness, is that's going to lead to life, but really it's a snare to death. God gives us life through Christ. Second thing is a call for repentance. That this is the time for us to put away excuses and rationales and justifications, is for us to repent and to apologize, to seek God's forgiveness, to turn away, whatever it is. Whatever it is on here, and that's between you and the Lord for you to work through as we sing Have Thine Own Way in just a minute. And for others of you, this is where you're saying, okay, March 3rd, I took some cold meds this morning. March 3rd, 2019 is the day that you commit to chase after, to pursue holiness and righteousness. Where you're like, whatever happened before now, it's done. I want to chase after this. So it's a call for commitment. And this is when you can do that. We're going to stand, we're going to sing. Some of you are going to stand and sing, and you're going to be praying through this. Others of you, you need to just sit down and do business with God. You need to do this commitment, this repentance. You need to trust Him. And then here's the biggest thing. When we wrap up, don't just fold, close, get out, go get lunch. God's done something in your life. If God's doing something when we sing, come and get one of us. Pastor Ron and I will be out in the crossroads room. Pastor Nathaniel will be over here by the door. Don't leave without talking to somebody if God's done something. Because what will happen is you get sucked into the distraction. And then it's done. The next thing you know, it's Tuesday, and you've forgotten what God did. Don't let that happen. So let's pray together.